We're going to talk about a very, very important topic about small for gestational age babies and particularly what happens to them over a long term. Now, we all know that there are a lot of short term implications which are there in SGA, particularly with regards to hypoglycemia, with regards to perinatal issues. But there are a lot of long term issues, especially with regards to growth, with regards to development, with regards to puberty and obesity, which are there. So today we are going to go through a lot of these issues and try to focus on key aspects of evaluation and management. And as in many parts of pediatric endocrinology, we need to have a careful mix of pre-regular evaluation and preventive measures to avoid long-term complications. There are a lot of implications, particularly with regards to growth, and we'll see how there is a dichotomous pattern in terms of when one group of individuals will grow a lot and that will cause more metabolic complications, while the other may not grow at all, resulting in short stature and other complications which are there in that regards. So we'll discuss about that in detail. All of you can go and have a look at our website, learning.growthsociety.in, which has got a lot of information about pediatric endocrinology, including courses in pediatric endocrinology. And we have recently launched our book, which is available both as a paperback as well as a Kindle version.
This is a slide of the normal bone, normal age, and normal weight of newborn. As in slide, it is showing that child is gaining normal achievement, normal milestone according to age, but it is not happen with the SGA child. So start with the weight and length. Birth weight and length is an important parameter to consider in clinical evaluation of newborn. It denotes the how fetus was in utero and how fetus was growing in utero. For this, we need to accurate about the birth weight and height, length that should be taken by infantometer. And should it these two parameters should be the very precise, and ideally it should be taken after 12 hours of birth. For definition of the SGA, we need three parameters. That first one is accurate knowledge about gestational age. That should be done by the USG in the first trimester. Second is birth weight, length, and head circumference. Ideally, this parameter should be taken by two care personnel according to Intergrowth 21 guideline. And third is we need the cutoff against the reference data from the population. This is the simple slide of definition of SGA. For the SGA, this is a slide showing any birth weight less than the 10 percentile is the SGA. Any birth weight greater than 19 centile, it is LGA. And between them, it is appropriate. So any child who born with the birth weight less than 10 centile and greater than 19 centile, they are more prone for the complications, particularly small for gestational age. According to this slide, we can divide SGA child into three categories. First is preterm SGA. Second is appropriate for weight SGA. And second is a postterm SGA. Now we see the criteria. according to this line is showing that child was short in the utero since beginning and child is that growth velocity is normal, that can be the SGA. So any birth weight less than 10 centile, we can tell as the SGA. But according to if we consider the length, birth weight or length less than 2 standard deviation of gestational age is SGA. Any birth weight less than the 2.5 kilogram, we can define as low birth weight. It is a term of irrespective of gestation. So now briefly look about SGA versus the IUGR. What is the difference between the two terminology? SGA refer to the body size and weight at the birth. It is a low weight and length at the non-gestational age. It is a prefer in absence of information of fetal growth. It can be the constitutional, while IUGR is always a pathological cause. For that IUGR, we need that criteria, plus we need two USG for growth assessment required.
when you're talking about SGA versus IUGR, which is more important from a clinical perspective? So if you are the pediatric endocrinologist, knew that this is IUGR and this is SGA, which is more important for you?
Sir, as we discussed already, SGA can be the constitutional or it can be normal, but IUGR having always a pathological causes, it can be the maternal cause, fetal cause or placental insufficiency.
So while we always talk about SGA and this topic is known as ISGA, I think we like to dispel this doubt that it is actually the growth restriction which is more important from our perspective. It is something like short stature and growth failure. So short stature is just like a snapshot, while growth failure is a longitudinal phenomena. Same here, IUGR means more important parameter. So even if your birth weight is normal, if there is evidence as shown nicely by your graph, which show that there's a decline in growth velocity, you have to be bothered. So if I actually get a reliable data as to how the growth was going in the fetal period, I'll be more concerned about IUGR than just being SGA, as you have nicely pointed. But this is very, very important point to remember, because IUGR usually mean there is a pathology. Child was fine, then did not grow. While SGA means he might have been small to begin with and he was small. So when we talk about growth failure, we say somebody who is very short, somebody who is short and not growing, and somebody who is crossing two or more percentile lines between 2 years to puberty is significant. Same, IUGR would mean that even if your birth weight is normal, you have crossed percentile lines, and you would talk about the charts that we should follow on that. That is a very, very important thing to remember. And that brings the importance of ultrasound recordings of growth as well as length. Now, we all get those length recordings, but they are not often taken into consideration. So ultimately, when we actually think of a discharge from the neonatal unit, we should probably add those ultrasound findings as well, because that will give you a better idea how they were growing rather than just going the birth weight. But we are using the term SGA because it is much easier to identify. You don't need a longitudinal assessment, but it's very important to actually think of. So this is a very, very valid point in that perspective.
Now we can carry forward. We can divide SGA into the four subgroup. SGA for the weight, SGA for the height, SGA for both weight and height, and SGA for the head circumference. First of all, why we have to divide this SGA into four groups? We are dividing both for the better etiology on in utero, what is the complication. For that perspective, we have to divide this SGA into four group. SGA for the weight, that means it's showing that child can be the normal in the later lifestyle. And second is SGA for the length, and SGA for both height and weight, that denotes it may be associated with early pathology and child may land up with some complication. And lastly, SGA for the head circumference, it denotes it is suggestive of previous early pathology, might be chromosomal pathology or placental insufficiency.
So if you have somebody who is SGA for weight versus SGA for length, who is more likely to have a growth failure?
Sir, SGA for the length having more complication, because the SGA having length, it denotes early pathology, might be the in second trimester.
So if you think in terms of acquired colon, it is like wasting and stunting. Huh. So if you have stunting, it basically means that you have a long duration of growth failure. Huh. Same is true for length. Fan will talk about how differents have a different odds ratio of having short stature. But this is very important. If you have the length data, that is better than the weight data. If you have a prospective length data, it is the best. Head circumference, of course, will be affected in a very severe case. Mm-hmm. So if your head circumference is low, you're talking about very early problems, maybe some viral infection and other things, which Naveen will talk about, will come into the picture. But I think from a clinician's perspective, we would be happy to at least have the length data from the birth, which becomes very important.
As in previous slide we discussed, we can briefly divide also SGA into two terminology, term SGA and preterm SGA. As the preterm SGA having the two entity, one is preterm and one is the SGA. So they land up with the more acute and chronic complications. For the monitoring of the SGA chart, we have various charts that start from the dances to the berries. It is a postnatal chart. It having demerits also, it taken from the small sample size, and it was some of the chart was not gender specific. So now we developed the Penton chart and modified Penton chart. according to modified Fenton chart, it took from the very large sample population that was around 4 million population. It is a descriptive type of study, and data take from 5 developed countries. In this modified Fenton chart, recent population based survey also included. And it starts from the 22 week of gestational to the 50 week of gestational. After that, we can merge it with the WHO growth chart.
If you have an ultrasound report of 26 weeks, how will you interpret that in this chart?
We can simply, as it is giving idea about the 22 to 50, we can easily simplify and we can.
So it is very important that these charts are available with the gynecologist who should plot in the beginning, and then they can carry it forward in terms of the post-delivery also, it becomes important in that regard. Now, when you talk about these sort of charts, what are the key criteria you need to want to have the population, which should be the ideal one to develop these charts?
Ideally, we have to take reference from the standard growth chart, and that high risk pregnancy and all should be excluded, and the infant who born the complication after birth, it should be excluded.
So this is a standard or a reference?
Sorry, this it is a standard.
So what do you mean by standard?
Standard is the local population. They can be pathological also, but the reference is generally normal.
Standard is what you're talking about reference. So standard means that you have the group of individuals in the weight ratio in a healthy population. So if you talk about WHO standards, as we talk about postnatal curves, we are talking about people who are actually breastfed, who actually have got no smoking in the mother, no diseases from affluent population. So that is the standard. So when you say standard, this is your bar. This much should the child grow if everything is normal. So same, this is like a reference. You're just taking a data of 4 million children and you've used that. It is not excluding everybody, and that causes confusion, which brings us to the next one, which is better on in that perspective.
Now, let's look about another guideline, Intergrowth 21 chart. It developed by International Fetal and Newborn Consortium, 21 century. It is a prescriptive standard for the fetus and the newborn growth. It developed from the 8 countries, China, Italy, India, Oman, Brazil, Kenya, UK and USA. Nagpur was centered from the India. It starts from the 14 weeks of gestational to the, we can plot up to the 64 week of gestational. It having 3 standard. First one is a fetus growth longitudinal standard. Second is a preterm, postterm, follow-up standard. Third is a newborn cross-sectional standard. In first standard, fetus growth longitudinal standard, they monitor fetal age by the ultrasound in first trimester. And second, preterm, postterm, follow-up standard, it developed from the 26 week of gestational to the 36 week of gestational, and all the parameter done after 12 hour of life. And third is a newborn cross-sectional standard that was taken from the large population, around 20,000 women, and that divide that chart into the 5th, 10th, 15, 19 and 97 centiles. This is the Indian comparison study of Fenton versus Intergrowth 21 chart that done in 2015 to 2017. They took 820 neonates. Out of that, they selected 623 children. And what is the conclusion between this comparison? They told that the infant identified as the IUGR at birth by Intergrowth chart and not by Fenton growth chart had higher incidence of morbidities. So according to them,
first thing you have to tell us is which one gives you more IUGR? Is it the Fenton or the Intergrowth?
So Intergrowth.
So Intergrowth are going to tell you that there are more children who are IUGR. Now, second question is that just because you are labeling somebody as IUGR does not mean that this is right. Suppose we talk about when we compare WHO to the IAP standard in our own study, we found that if you use IAP criteria for children with short stature, IAP will give you more short stature or WHO will give you more short stature?
So WHO.
WHO will more because it's a more strict thing. But the big question is those individuals who are short by WHO, but not short by IAP, do they have a pathology or not? So what we really found out in that perspective was that the pathology was not increased. which means that it is no sense of picking up so many children who are normal. So you are basically labeling normal individuals as abnormal. So what is very important here is that the point you have noted is that the inter-group chart is actually better off in picking up in terms of morbidity. So when you want to follow a chart, why do you want to do a SGA identification? Because you want to say how much risk of hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, all those complications and long-term complications. So that's why the definition-wise, this will be much better as compared to the Fenton chart. So this is very, very clear study which shows in that regard.
Now, epidemiology. In this slide, it is showing that Southern Asia having the more chance, more prevalence of the SGA than the other part. Minimum number of the prevalence in the Eastern Asia, like Japan and all countries, and India and other countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan having more prevalence of the SGA than the other. Thank you.
So I think very, very important points which Manoj has brought out are come out from this is that one, we need to actually have a continuous monitoring using ultrasound, which will tell us information and these should be plotted beforehand. So ideally when the child is, there is a maternal care being given, we should start plotting right away from that side, then only it will make more sense. IOGR is definitely much more important than SGA. SGA is a single value. It has got very limited information, but if nothing is available, it is good enough. So I would prefer a continuous monitoring of growth, preferable, not available, at least birth length. Then the worst, of course, is the birth weight, which is available. Most cases, we just get a birth weight, but I think we need to move from birth weight to birth length. And this length and indices, which Naveen will also talk about, give us a lot of information about what is the type of growth and how they will predict from there in that perspective. The third major point which is coming is there, inter-growth standard is definitely suitable unless and until we have a prospective Indian standard, which is developed. So like IAP came in, then we thought we knew the problems of WHO. Same is that if we get some data from India, that is fine. But till then, inter-growth is better than Fenton's. It's something like CDC versus WHO. If you think about in growth charts we were doing, and we found that CDC was actually overestimating problems, but it was not causing pathology. Same as you showed very clearly that inter-growth is a better predictor of morbidity, which is the aim of monitoring. Otherwise, why would we monitor? So I think three main things is ultrasound monitoring, birth length, and very importantly, to follow them up and look particularly with the inter-growth chart.